In this video, I'd like to give you all a bit of an insight into my toy design and prototyping process. This is going to be a two-part video, starting with the software side of things, while part two will deal with the physical aspects of printing, assembly, and painting. Usually, the way to go about this is to start with a 2D design or scribbles, which I still do sometimes, but for the design of the Age of Mecha toys, I went a different way, creating all the designs directly in 3D with Maya. The reason for this is that after many years of drawing especially hard surface designs like the mechs, I developed a sort of muscle memory. If you are an artist, this may sound familiar to you. Over the years, you get used to your lines and directions and shapes and repeat them instinctively, and it can become hard to find new and interesting shapes. Many people suggest just trying to draw with your other hand to get a new feel, which may lead to new shapes. However, what I found to help me a lot is to jump directly to 3D and start designing with rough and primitive shapes. Just quads, spheres, cubes, moving them around and rearranging them until I find interesting shapes, always checking the silhouette and see if I can find something I like. It might be a lengthier process than designing your pieces up front with drawings, but for me it led to discovering new ideas and new shapes, which I just couldn't formulate with my drawings. But this is just my approach. Anyone should just start however they're comfortable. There is no right or wrong way. It all depends on what you're happy with and what works best for you. So what I'm doing here is just laying out basic ideas for the underlying mech frame, starting from the hip and working down to the feet, just to get a basic idea what the legs of my mech should look like. Since working with primitives is so easy and quick, I can instantly adjust shapes and parts until I get a form and silhouette I like. It's oftentimes just trial and error until I found something I want to work with. Over the course of this process, I refine my shapes and add detail. Here you can see a few iterations over time, how the basic idea evolved in this process. What's also great about working directly in 3D is that you can attach your parts to a simple rig and testing your functionality and joint designs to see how the parts move. Are there intersections? Can I pose it the way I want? Are there any limits to poseability, etc. In this stage, you can easily adjust your parts and designs, so the final toy will be able to have all this poseability. When I'm happy and confident with the basic design, I export my parts to ZBrush, where I can refine them further and prepare them for printing. ZBrush is a great tool, especially for hard surface modeling and creating printable parts. Here you can see I already worked out a lot of the details on the frame, arms and legs. I usually start with separating and hollowing out parts, adding functionality to the parts, like adding pegs and peg holes, snap-fit cantilevers, and creating cutouts for all the functional hinge and ball joints. Here you can see how easily this is done with Dynameshes inside ZBrush. Once I have my parts all functional, I can start adding surface detail. Since the mechs all belong to the same universe, it is essential to have some design similarities throughout all the models, which make them instantly recognizable. I use a lot of predefined brushes to add and distribute detail on the surface of the parts. They all occur in the different mech designs in varying sizes and amounts, but those details are instantly recognizable throughout the designs and give that feeling that they all belong into the same world. When I'm happy with the details, I create a copy of my parts and reduce their file size with the Decimation Master plugin. This reduces poly count from millions to mere thousands of polygons and greatly reduces file saving and opening times, while at the same time keeping all the crisp detail. I usually use a value of 6% of the original resolution, which gives a great result with a very small file size. This is especially important when it comes to preparing the print files in the preform software later on, since it saves you a lot of time. Next, I export my printable parts to STL format. Before I print out my parts, I import them back to Maya once more to prepare them. Since I have so many parts per prototype, I need to organize them in an efficient way. For example, I'd like to have all the parts of the Fatboy's torso in one print file, like you can see them here. To use the space on the build platform sufficiently, I recreated the build volume measurements as a template to help me organize, position and orient the parts efficiently. Most important in my case is orientation. Here you can see how the parts are oriented in a way that the support structures that are needed for the 3D print will attach to the underside of the parts, where they don't interfere with the surface detail and that the parts are separated and not overlapping. You'll better see this in the next segment, where I show you how to prepare the parts in preform. Preform is the printing software provided by Formlabs. In the software itself, you can position and orient your parts and generate support structures. When importing complex part files, they often need to be repaired first. This is happening quite frequently and pretty much normal. Just takes a few seconds and the print parts are good to go. Since Maya uses the Y-up axis and Preform the Z-up axis coordinate system, the parts have to be reoriented first. Fortunately, there are presets, so this can be done by the push of a button. Next, I have to create the support structures. Notice that the bottom of the grid represents the bottom of the build platform. Since the Form 3 prints upside down, you have to basically imagine this to be turned on its head. These are the settings I'm really comfortable with and save me a lot of resin. Then I just auto-generate the support structures. After a short waiting time, the structures are placed and the printability calculation starts. If all is greenlit, I can then check if the software missed a spot, like something that wouldn't print because of a missing support strut. If so, I can easily adjust each support strut individually, but in almost all cases, I'm good to go. Then it's just aligning the print on the platform and sending it to the printer. I hope you enjoyed this video. In the upcoming part 2, I'm going to show you the process of 3D printing, cleaning up the prints, assembling the parts, and how they are painted. If you enjoyed this video, please leave a like and subscribe to my channel. And also remember to sign up for the Kickstarter launch notification through the link in the video description. Thank you for watching.